Now I would love to re-invite a guest to the stage, whose bio is quite impressive. He is the youngest Nobel laureate in physics since 1971 and the youngest overall since 1992. Together with André Geim, he worked on graphene, which led to the Nobel Prize in 2010. Welcome back on stage, Konstantin Novoselov.
Sorry, guys, it's me again.
Here's the clicker.
Yes,
back to
thank
you. And thank you for your time.
You thought you would get rid of me so easily. Unfortunately, not. Okay, so I'll try to be quick. I do realize that I'm the only one who stands between you and the dinner. And okay, well, I'll just try to run quickly, and now you can relax. So it's not much to understand, or you can shout questions if there is anything unclear. And basically, it's the I thought I would tell you the story of sp2 carbon, and the basic reason for this is that when so prior to graphene, I never worked on carbon at all, and so we've been working on something completely different. And then when we started to work on graphene, I started to question myself, where is so we used a lot of graphite, and I thought, well, so where is graphite is coming from? And it turns out that it was discovered really close by, very close to Manchester, and then it's basically evolved into a little hobby of mine. So I travel different graphitic mines in the world, and basically I'll try to tell you. And then it turned out that the story of graphite actually is quite connected to the northwest of England. So I decided to tell you a little bit of a story of the sp2 carbon. Now, for those who don't really understand some of the words, so I guess the word story you do know. Carbon, I will just explain, and let me explain you what sp2 means. So the easiest way is to start with the periodic table. So carbon is of course number six. So hydrogen, helium, lithium, beryllium, boron, carbon. So six means that it has six electrons in total. Two on the lowest shell, doesn't participate in chemistry at all. And then the remaining four. So we have two electrons which form the so-called s. The s orbital, so this yellow spherical cloud, and two got this pi dumbbell shell shape orbitals, and then you can excite one of the electrons from the yellow into another purple cloud. So, but there are still four of them: one yellow in the middle, and four dumbbell shells. So, and then when carbon wants to participate in a chemical reaction, what it does, it tries to expand those orbitals, and it does it by combining this middle yellow orbital with one or the other of the purple ones. And then if it combines only one yellow and one purple, it's so-called S. It combines one S and one P. It has two chemical bonds. If it combines the two purple and one yellow, it's sp2. So it has three chemical bonds and four chemical bonds if all of them are hybridized. So now you understand this mystery of what sp2 means. And it's basically carbon atom who tries to participate in chemical reaction with three other atoms around. Interestingly, so all of those hybridizations can be found in nature. So in the simplest form, it's two carbon atoms and then saturated with hydrogen. So this molecule is called ethane, ethylene. If carbon is in sp2 hybridization, so each of the carbons has two hydrogen and connected to another carbon as well, and then acetylene if it's in the sp hybridization. So the proper what I didn't know actually, that the proper chemical names, I'm trying to stay as far away from chemistry as possible, so this is probably my limit. And so the proper chemical names actually have got the coding of this sp2, sp3, sp by the central vowel. If it is A, it should be sp3. If it is E, then it's sp2. If it is Y, it's sp. And hence graphene. So there is E in the middle. We immediately know that it has carbon. So that carbon is in sp hybridization. Some of you who worked with graphene, you know that we also worked with graphene when we add hydrogen on top. So the A is coming from this as well. And actually, it has an interesting connection to the Chinese name of graphene, Simoshi, which also is the carbon which is hybridized in the sp2 hybridization. So there is lots in the name. Anyway, so sp2 hybridization, it means it's basically graphite. And for you, so if you want the crystal analogy of graphite, but in sp3 hybridization, it's diamond. So some of you might wonder why the hell we're talking about sp2 carbon, which is graphite, soft, smudgy, dirty. It's much more fun to talk about diamonds, of course. Well, there are three reasons. One is that I told you that. So we're talking about the history of diamond. So diamonds are known for 3,000 years. Graphite are known for only 500 years. So it's 2,500 years less for me to cover today, and we only have got 37 minutes left. And diamonds, despite what they say that diamonds are forever, in fact, diamonds are not stable, they're metastable state. So your diamonds actually gradually turn on the surface into graphene and then shed away. So after maybe 10 million years, your diamonds would just go into nothing. So follow Sergei's advice, invest your money not in diamonds but in quantum computers, or in graphene if you want. So it's much more stable for sure. And also, I mean, for a scientist, so we're still paid in pencils, right? Not in diamonds. So I don't think it would be appropriate for me to talk about diamonds. Anyway, where is this number 500 years is coming from? And it's quite interesting. You can find it in the royal papers when two royal commissioners traveled to the north of England, to the Borrowdale Vale and the valley, and they found that some of the locals used this soft stone, which they didn't even know what it is. They called it plumbaga at the time, so related to lead. And they absolutely had no clue how to use it, and yet they established the taxation on it immediately. So there's the typical governance, and then since then it started to be mined in that area. So that area, so it's very close to to Manchester. You can easily find it on the map in the Lake District. So those of you who like hiking, it's really really picturesque place. You can go there and you can see those mines, the heaps, the waste material, even on Google Map. So that's exactly what we did. There is a legend, as usual, so that there was an ash tree and the lightning strike, and then it fell down, and underneath there was the cavity with this soft stone. You can find this ash tree and then go inside those holes, and it's really beautifully carved. Mines, so you can actually carved by German miners back in 1555. So some of them are so-called coffin layers, because so they only carved exactly to the shape of a human body, so you could pass by. So it has wider on the shoulder, just really really narrow on your feet, so you can still go there. It's not guarded at all, and it's miles just running across, so you can carve your own graphite there. So would definitely recommend anyone to go. So for us, what we thought is, Can we prove that indeed this 500 years is the oldest what we know about graphite? Because it doesn't seem so. For graphite, very, very simple material, only 500 years that we know it. Sounds a bit silly, and we were doing some research and it turned out that those mines back in 1400 belonged to Furness Abbey. It's a beautiful abbey also in the Lake District, maybe about 80 miles away from those from the mines. And so what is interesting that it was founded it's much much earlier than graphite was found, and they owned those mines. And also in their books, it is written that something like soft stone was traded by the monks of this Furness Abbey. So we were trying to figure out, is it really the case? And luckily, this abbey left the two books, so-called the Kausche books. Is basically chronicles from 1412, and those books still exist in quite a good conditions. Really 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 beautiful books. Again, if you have a chance in London, go and get one. I was absolutely amazed how easy is it. So you go to British Library, they ask, do you have a recommendation? You write yourself a recommendation on the university, on SIT letterhead, and then in the same day you get access. And then when they gave it to me, so just really across, I've been to libraries in Germany. You really have to wear lots of gloves and masks not to breathe on it. 1400 books, they just give it to you, and then you just do whatever you want with this. Absolutely beautiful books, beautifully illuminated. But what is special that this manuscript is actually lined up. So it's handwritten, but it's also lots of lines actually striked under. So it's lined up, and it looks like it's the pencil. So it's just so those lines we got. Yeah, all those lines, they look like pencil lines. So they're like gray in color. And then we just made two and two together. So we worked with Andrea Ferrari, who was there before. So we thought, can it be the first use of graphite? Because they owned those mines, so they wrote those manuscripts would be quite logical. So it's not very common for monasteries from that time to be lined up. Some of them were, some of them were not. And so we were just trying to investigate those books. So there are two of them: one in London Archive, one in the British Library. We went to the British Library. I asked for the book, can we take this book and then take it to our lab, and then we just do some study. They said no, absolutely not. It cannot leave the library. We said okay, can we just take a small amount of the sample and investigate it? And those guys in the conservation, they're so proud. They say you don't understand this, and he just makes like a move with his palm on the surface of this book. It's so precious. I can't give it to you. And I think, gosh, you just now you collected more than enough sample on your palm for me to investigate. Anyway, we had to carry all our Raman systems into the library, so just align it and so on. Unfortunately, it turned out to be that it's not graphene, so we just investigated all those lines. So this one looks very much like graphite. Unfortunately, it turned out to be that it's the iron going, and so this date of 1555 still stands. And then, so the 1555 is the first mentioning of graphite in the royal papers. 1565, we already see it's the first depiction of a pencil in the book published by Konrad Gerstner in Zurich in the year of his death. Most likely he never even saw this graphite, but we know that it's it comes from England. He called it steamy aglicum, so English antimonide. And so of course they didn't know about carbon at the time. Konrad Gerstner probably had never seen the pencil, so he actually got it from Germany, so the description of it from Germany, and from Hannes Kentman. But pencils were probably one of the biggest use of graphite at the time, and it really became extremely popular material for this purpose. However, of course, pencils were not the only use of graphite. Surprisingly, equally large use was as food additive. Mainly, they were adding it to wine, and often as medicine, often for some other purpose which we still don't understand. I really have no clue, but some years ago I got an article in Times magazine, and I should admit I really don't understand this. They were trying to associate the adjectives which we attribute to wines with the price. Like many people call the wine fruity or woody or stony and apparently graphitic wines is usually the graphitic taste is associated with some of the most expensive wines. I have absolutely no idea how graphitic, what is the graphitic taste of wine, but that's maybe it's a coincidence, maybe it's the reality. Then it's used as a lubricant, for gunpowder. But again, most important probably was the mold casting for mainly to build cannonballs, because it's easy to polish, easy to carve, and graphite is the material with the highest melting point. So the owners of those mines, they quickly realized, so for many, many years, so that mine in England was the only supplier of graphite in the world. So can you imagine, for good 200 years, it was the only supplier of graphite in the world. And the owners, of course, realized it very quickly that they are the monopoly. So they increased the prices really rapidly. So the inflation was huge. So they started from £13 per ton in the beginning. And then it rose to 13 shilling per pound, which is £2,000 per ton. So the price was actually huge. So 17 shilling per pound, what it means that one rock, just like the size of your fist, would give you a complete monthly wage. So 17 shilling is the monthly wages for those miners. What it created, it created a huge illegal market of graphite, because it's so simple. You simply slip this rock into your pocket, and then you have your monthly wage. So the situation was so severe that they passed a special act through the parliament dealing only with illegal access to graphitic mines. So there was only one mine in the whole world, and so it was protected by a special law. So the theft of graphite is the public whipping, and then year of hard labor down under. Or being transported down under for 7 years, and I always tell my students it's still enforced. If you ever touch graphene, so just hard labor for 4 years as PhD, and then public whipping at your exam at a Viva. So they actually say that the term black market originated from the illegal market which existed of graphite, which existed in 17th, 18th century Britain. So it's not my idea. So it's the story I read in the Pencil Museum down in Keswick there. So then for a good couple of hundred years, nothing happened with graphite until the Napoleonic Wars, so French Revolution, and then there is a French blockade, and then England blockades France. So basically there were pencils supplied from England were extremely popular everywhere in the world, and then suddenly England stopped supplying those pencils to France, and then Napoleon charged this young gentleman, Nicolas Jacques Cantin, with trying to recreate the pencils in France. So I should say that the high quality graphite was only mined at one place in the world, but the low quality powder graphite was available elsewhere as well. And then Nicolas Cantin, he experimented with mixing graphite with some with clay, with some binders, and he basically came with what we know as the modern pencil. And the company which he established based on the production of those pencils, first pencils, still exists. So Cantin, you can buy pencils which are the consequence of the blockade during the French the Napoleonic Wars. Again, then it was a slow development in the history until this gentleman came to the stage, John Desmond Burnau, with the nickname Sage. So very smart guy, but very unconventional as well, a socialist. And so he was a crystallographer, the student of William Bragg, and one of his students was Dorothy Hodgkins. And so he basically figured out the crystal structure of graphite using his advanced crystallography techniques. So I read his first publication on this. So he discovered the layer structure and the AB stacking of graphite. And I read his paper, very interesting, simple paper, but one figure was really, really nice. It's just figure five, so it has the picture of his sample, and then just a dot the real size of his crystals. And then I read his memoirs, and I realized why he was doing this, because he always suffered from his chore lady, who would clean his desk, and he lost quite a few samples through the cleaning. And in his lab. So he was actually quite an interesting guy. He had two interesting projects during the war. So one was the project on ice aircraft carriers. So of course, England, there was a shortage of metal in England at the time, and the situation was so desperate that Brits were trying to create aircrafts from ice. So actually, not from only ice, from so-called picrates. So it's it's basically mixture of ice with wood pulp, and they created one, I think, which was reasonably successful, but then it didn't go further. But he also worked on another project Mulberry for the temporary harbors, and he was also awarded. So his teacher was awarded Nobel Prize. His student awarded Nobel Prize. He only got the Stalin Peace Prize. So he was a known socialist. Then the next story. So then we basically knew pretty much everything around about graphite. Except that a lot of science of graphite was actually associated with the nuclear power stations, which was also close to those original mines, and there was a terrible disaster in the UK on the Seaside plant, and it was due to melting of the reactor, but melting not on of the nuclear power or of the nuclear material, but graphite catched fire due to accumulation of the defects during irradiations, the so-called nuclear graphite, and that really caused a lot of work on the structure of graphite. So due to that disaster, so we actually know quite a lot about sp2 carbon. And then the next interesting story is the story about C60, when we started to create. So up to that moment, we only had one type of sp2 carbon, graphite. After C60, we realized that there are many other structures as well, mainly nanostructures, and so it's due to the work of Harry Crotter, as well as Robert Crow and Richard Smalley. So Harry was studying the absorption spectra of carbon stars, and there were a lot of interesting peaks which he thought are coming from some long carbon chains, and he basically traveled over to over to Texas to synthesize in situ those lone carbon chains and try to measure their spectroscopy and mass specs. And the story is really interesting. So he traveled there on the 1st of September. They submitted article, their first paper, within 2 weeks, and it was accepted within a month, and published unbelievably fast for a scientific paper. And it's not a surprise, because the whole paper is barely two-page, well, one page of text, three figures, and out of those three figures, one figure is the football. And the reason it's football, because C60 is the molecule which consists of 60 carbon atoms, and it has exactly the structure of a football. It consists of pentagons and hexagons. Of course, only hexagons would give you a planar structure to make it spherical. You need a number of pentagons as well. So those cage molecules were C60. They were named buckyballs. Buck means the fullerenes, after these famous architects who was creating geodesical domes. So many structures in this form. And the interesting story about it, that if you scale from C60 to the real ball, is the same ratio as from the football to the to Earth. So then you can think about it logically, though of course people never did, so that if you start putting extra chains of carbon into those C60, you would probably get into something like carbon nanotubes. No one actually thought about it, and no one predicted, until Sumer in Geim actually saw some unexpected structures, straight lines in his TEM, and he realized that it must be carbon tubes, or double, triple, and multiple wall carbon nanotubes. So, and that basically gave us yet another form of sp2 carbon, so-called carbon nanotubes. Russians would have a problem with this, because quite a bit before, which is quite established now, these two guys have seen the same structures, but seeing and not explaining is not the same. So Sumer Ijima is considered to be the discoverer of the carbon nanotubes, and quite rightfully so. So then we're basically now at the stage where we have graphite, sp2 carbon, sp2 carbon 60, and then carbon nanotubes. So, and you can see that we basically cover all the possible dimensionalities except dimensionality 2. Of course, people filled in this gap theoretically long time ago. They thought about the possibility of graphene, and they use it in their calculations, because it's of course is the simplest possible form, and theorists would never try to calculate anything complicated. So they would calculate the property of graphene, and then extract the property of all the other materials, sp2 materials, from it, because buckyballs is of course wrapped graphene, carbon nanotubes are just rolled graphene, and graphite is the graphene layers stuck one upon each other. And actually people didn't believe that graphene does exist for a number of good reasons. So first of all, there is the very fundamental theorem, the so-called Neumann-Wagner theorem, that two-dimensional crystals should be unstable. and then there are a number of other things why it shouldn't exist in its free state. And typically the reason is that when you try to grow it at high temperature, it would just collapse into some other structures. And but of course, what we do, the trick we do by with the exfoliation, with the scotch tape technique, the reason it is stable because we do it at room temperature and we basically peel it from the substrate. So it is it does become stable. So we basically started with the scotch tape. So that's the typical. So that's how this exfoliation looks like. You peel from the high quality graphite. You peel some layers, put it on a special substrate. So here it's selected in such a way that different thicknesses would be seen as different colors. So the more bluish it is, the more the thinner it is. And then if you take low quality graphite, this sort of goes into your pencil, your samples will be really, really small, tiny. These days we can produce from high quality graphite, so North Korea or Sri Lanka, we get really huge, huge crystals. Though I'll tell you later that we can grow or we can mass produce those huge crystals even on the square meters range, maybe even square kilometers. So I had this slide for some time, and someone asked me, have you actually done exfoliation of the actual pencils? And for some time I would say that we've never done it, so you can basically make all the devices with it. But some time ago I collaborated on some artistic project with Cornelia Parker, and she insisted that, so Cornelia Parker is the contemporary artist, quite a established British contemporary artist, and then she insisted that we needed to actually exfoliate graphene and get graphene from actual pencils, but not from just any pencils, but from pencils which were used by big shots like Blake, Constable, Picasso. So this is Gürtin. So we went to the local art gallery. I asked for went into the storage, asked for those drawings, and worked better than in the British Library before. So I carefully removed the unnecessary bits from those drawings. I promise I only made it more beautiful than they were. And then was so we could produce, so the graphene part is barely visible, it's just over there. So this one is from Blake, so this is from Picasso. So the answer is yes, you can make graphene from the from pencils, and we had some devices made from Blake and Constable and Gürtin and Picasso. It's a separate long story, so maybe once I'll tell you what did we do with those. So it was a long artistic project. So basically we're now at graphene. I'll spend 3 minutes just telling you that a lot of these unusual properties are actually coming from the fact that we have this honeycomb lattice. Because the honeycomb lattice, it looks simple, but in fact it's not one of the simple Bravais lattices. So there are only five types of the lattices which exist in two dimensions, and the honeycomb lattice is not one of them. So you need to have two atoms for per unit cell to create this lattice. So I color them red and green. Even we all, of course, know that carbon atoms are blue. But so here now you have to allow your electron to quantum mechanically sit on both atoms simultaneously, and from and that's from that's where all these interesting graphene properties are coming from. And just for you, just to explain, most of the why it's so special. So most materials in the world can be divided into electron-type metals and hole-type metals, where electrons conduct electricity or holes conduct electricity. Negatively charged quasiparticle, positively charged quasiparticles. Now, they're all described by the Schrödinger equation. And if I need to simplify it even further, it's like having a country with a single party system, and then you can move freely within the country. But then if you try to bring these two types, different types of materials together, you form a so-called PN junction, and then you basically create a border control, and you can control the flow of electrons like you control the flow of people on the border. So that's in a nutshell how modern transistors operate. Graphene is fundamentally different, and it has both electrons and holes at the same time, and it's like United States. So this is from previous electrons, and those states can be Republican or Democratic, but you still can cross the border, and that's what electrons in graphene do. You cannot stop them, so they always fly without any scattering at all. So they never see any scattering. So that's why they're good for high frequency transistors. And okay, I'll just skip this. So it has a number of unique properties, of course. But then those unique properties are quite good for a number of different applications. And before just showing you the future applications, I can tell you what graphene has done for us already. Well, first of all, it created lots of workplaces. Lots of my former PhD students, they started a number of companies, some more successful than the others. And it was meant as a joke until I received my regular copy of the Glamour magazine, where on one of the pages you read five jobs our kids will be doing, and then right next to virtual architect, avatar stylist, active makeup developer, there is also graphene engineer. And if it is mentioned by Glamour, it must be true, of course. It also provides entertainment. I'm sure that some of you, or many of you, have seen this sitcom, and unfortunately disrupted. So I met the guy. So, and then in one of the episodes, so Sheldon was trying to figure out why electrons in graphene behaves as massless quasi-relativistic particles. You already know because of the honeycomb lattice, but this guy spends a whole episode, and the reason is that this formula is wrong. So actually, it is for bilayer graphene, not for monolayer graphene. It also gives shelter. If you fancy living in Tallahassee, Florida, you can go and live on graphene lane. But in reality, it actually followed the footsteps of many other, in terms of applications, followed exactly the footsteps of many other advanced materials. Same as, I don't know, carbon nanotubes or carbon fibers. First, it goes into the sport goods, composite materials, tennis rackets, small improvements of properties. You pay a lot of money. The ultimate money story was when we combined efforts with Richard Miller and McLaren to create this world lightest, unfortunately also world most expensive watch as well. 1 million Swiss franc for 32 grams. And so we also same technology goes into the textile engineering. So you can make functional textiles. So we do this work with our Chinese colleagues in Chongqing. So you basically can stop the you make fire retardant textiles. Lindsay here, so she created graphene dress, and unfortunately the video doesn't work, but it's so she puts through graphene, she puts sensors inside and she can read some characteristics. And then if you don't have 1 million Swiss, you can spend quarter of a million on this sport car with graphene, and it's for real. And I thought they would use it because of the light, of the lightness, and because of the mechanical strength. In fact, graphene, because of its high thermal conductivity, it's actually goes makes the production of those those panels much faster. And these days, all of the Ford cars, they actually have graphene under the bonnet, again, for some unexpected reason. It's for it's because of the noise canceling properties. You would, from the hindsight, you would guess that lots of interfaces create a lot of scattering for the phones, but you really need to think about it. And then from noise canceling into noise creation, so it's so some of the world's best headphones are made from graphene, because the membrane needs to be stiff and light at the same time, and that's all graphene. And then in terms of electronic applications, so it's Huawei phones works that they use a lot of graphene these days. But basically, just to finish it, what we hope to get from those 2D crystals and from graphene are the applications which could never be done before and could never be predicted. So just to tell you about one, it's the adaptive contact lenses. So you take a contact lens, put some graphene, another graphene layer on top, and then fill in the gap with the liquid crystal, and you basically can, by applying voltage, you can adapt the optical power of your lenses. And that's basically how it's, so that's something which you cannot do without graphene, because it needs to be conductive, flexible, and transparent. And I think I will stop here, and thank you so much for attention, and we're all free to go for dinner now. Thank you. Okay. We have a question, Karen. There's always one guy or two guys who stand between you and the dinner, so okay. Hate them, go ahead.
Did you try wine with graphene?
No. But we can try. I guess
May I interrupt? The There's a microphone coming, so you can ask the question again. Thank you.
Did you try wine infused with graphite?
No, but so the answer is no. Why? I don't know. But it's probably an idea for startup. So Sergey, you can invest. So graphitic wine, right? Okay. But we can try. We can
you
all
want me to comment something. And it's no, I just have two comments to add to Kostya's presentation. I just couldn't hold it. So one is that in Acronis, we made a watch which is produced from graphene,
which is made in
Schaffhausen, and which will be sold next year for less than $25,000.
And it's really beautiful.
It's a really nice watch. Graphene itself is not expensive. The brand is expensive.
For the Richard Mille, it was branding for those produced by Moser. It's for real. It's in the body and in the rubber parts, and it's definitely so. The yang modulus increases dramatically, and the wear resistance increases dramatically as well.
And the other comment is that Kostya has been. Subtle, because just recently there is magic angle graphene superconductors, which is one of the new leading fields in physics, where you take a graphene, twist it a little bit, and it becomes superconductor. And that's like, so it's a material which is potentially going to generate two fields in physics already. Yeah. So it's not so simple.
Yeah,
and two options for the Nobel Prize.
Great. So this is the topic for tonight dinner, probably. Right. Great. So.
Yes. So I'm going to wrap it up. Yeah. Thank you so much for this spontaneous Q&A. Thank you very much. So, a very interesting day one comes to an end. And I would love to say thank you. Thank you to the team, to everyone involved, to all of our speakers, and for sure, to our audience. So, everyone that is tuned in online, we see us each at 9 o'clock in the morning. Everyone who's here at, with us, please stay just for a second because there's some more information upcoming. But for our online community, thank you so much. See you again tomorrow morning at 9 o'clock. Have a good night. Thank you.